Hi guys, I'm here in the insulation valve for the scrubber system, and you can see from this black pipe that we receive biogas from the blowers. We have two blowers running in parallel, and the gas come here and pass through this isolation valve. In the case of the plant shutdown, if we don't have gas, this valve closes and there is no gas to the process. And let's start with this valve. You can see as with its body is a typical body of a butterfly valve, and you can identify that also seeing its actuator. If the actuator is aligned with the pipe, it means that the valve is full open, and when it closes, this disc turns around and goes to the closed position. That means that the line is perpendicular to the pipe direction. It's a big valve. This pipe has around equivalent to 20 inches. It is not size in inches because it's a different material from stainless steel and carbon steel, so we have this in the size in millimeters. And here you can see that we have also, instead of the isolation valve that is automatic, the valve is actuated based on some process parameters. We have also a manual valve here, an isolation valve, but in this case manual. This is also a butterfly valve, and to close this we use the handle, and you can verify that this valve also has the disc. And as I told you before, if the line is at the same direction that the pipe, it means that it is full open. And if it goes to perpendicular to the pipe, it means that it's closed. And here it's easy to identify this information because we have it marked formation in the valve. And the pipeline has a head here, and we have another butterfly valve in the field, but in this case it is flanged, it's not connected with anything, and because it is a standby valve, or as we also known as a tying point. So in the future, if I have another pipe with another supply of biogas, I can connect here without doing any intervention in the existing pipe. And sometimes it is usual to let this kind of resources, because we prevent the shutdown of the plant to do an intervention. Here we have also a butterfly valve, and as this valve is not to be operated, its wheel was removed. And here we have a vent. As the gas is saturated at the temperature of the blower discharge during the night, it's usual to have condensation in this pipe, so we have some points of venting, and we eventually have liquid here. I will not open that to not disturb the process, but you is just to let you know. And the pipe goes to the inlet of the scrubber. We have another butterfly valve there, and you can see that the scrubber has a material different than the pipe. And let's check if the valve is open. It's obvious that it's open, but you can see in the disc. We cannot see the disc because in this position the disc is up to the sky, so I will not be able to verify. But as the plant is running, we know that the valve is open. It's starting, so the gas enters the scrubber from the bottom. It walks through the scrubber to the top, where we have another black pipe there in the top of this tower or of this column. And it with the temperature, with decreased temperature, it enters in another column where we have the H2S removal. That's another part of the process. I will not focus on that, but I will show you in details the scrubber system. And to wash the gas, we have water recirculation, and the water is so here we have the nozzle of the outlet. Here we have the hot water that was in contact with the biogas. So here is the suction of the pumps. Here we have two horizontal pumps, and so we have a curve, and we have an isolation valve. This kind of valve is a bow valve, and you can verify its body, that it is a 3 inches and 300 pounds glass material. That means that the flanges is rated for 300. And we have also a strainer. In this case, the strainer is for 150 pounds and 3 inches also. And there is no mistake here because we have a low pressure at this vessel. It runs around no more than 2 millibars, so the 150 pounds is okay for this service, and also the 300. The only matter is that the valves for 300 is more expensive than one for 150, but maybe it was available at the site, so it's better to use that than buy another one. And here we have the horizontal pump. The blue part is the motor, and the flow comes in the horizontal and gets in vertical, outside in the vertical. We have an isolation valve here also. That is a ball valve, and we can see its size in its body. 2 inches, 300 pounds. We have here a pressure tap where we have a manometer. So this is the PI and the PNID, and we have an isolation valve, a ball valve also. And in this case, it is half an inches, and you can see that this pump is not running, it's shut off because there is zero pressure here. And at the discharge downstream, the pressure tap, we have a check valve. In the second pump, the arrangement is the same, with block valve at the pumping lead, strainer, the isolation valve at pump discharge, pressure tap. We have also here a vent, the same in the other pump, and we have the manometer measuring around 2.5 bar G. It's almost dead. Impact is 2.25 bar G. So this, it is the red of the pump. It means that there is a column of liquid in the scrubber, and the pump adds some pressure for this liquid, and the result of this is a pressure of around 2.5 bar G. So I was talking about the pump discharge, and we have the pump discharge joined in this head of water, and downstream the pumps we have strainer, and we have here a solenoid valve that it closes depending on the process conditions, and a isolation valve there. Hidden here we have another isolation valve and a bypass in a case that we need to clean the filter. We temporarily let the process without cleaning the liquid, and it goes to the process. And we use that filter to make sure that the heat exchanger will not be blocked. Just to see in more details, here we have the block valve that, as you can see, is a ball valve also. Here we have the strainer, the solenoid valve, and electric supply, and the block valve that is a ball valve also. And we can verify the size of this pipe taking a look in the flange. Here we have a 2 inches pipe. We can see that also in the valve body, 2 inches. And this pipe leads the liquid stream to the heat exchanger. This kind of heat exchanger is a plate one. I will show you how it works. And we have here We have here a chilled water pipe that comes from the two chillers, that comes from the chiller system, where the temperature is around 2 to 5 Celsius, and we have a control valve here. This is a TV valve that is responsible to control the temperature of the recirculation water. Because it is operating in a lower temperature, we need to add to the piping system insulation. So it is an insulation, and you can see here that we have a block valve and another block valve and a bypass for control valve maintenance purpose, and based on the handle of this valve, we can assume that it is a ball valve also. And we have 3 ball valves, and it's not because we have this box here, we cannot say which kind of control valve it is. But based on CNID, we can verify that. This valve is supplied by Fisher, a very reliable supplier, and we have here the air for its actuator, and we have some actuator information in the body of the actuator. So here is the diaphragm. So the valve opens or closes based on the air that has in this enclosure. So the valve opens or closes depending on the pressure in the head of the valve. Different from the isolation valve here, that is a ball valve one, this is open or closed. It's not modulated, it's not for control, it's only for isolation. And as the same concept as the for butterfly valves, if we have the collar aligned with the pipe, we have this valve open and it is perpendicular to the pipe direction. This one means that it is closed. The actuation is electrical, so we have electric. It's not electric. It is a interface with the control room, and we have a instrument air here also. So this valve is actuated by instrument air, and this have a switch that indicates in the control room if it is open or closed. And this one is electrically actuated, so there is no instrument air in this valve, so if we turn off the power, it closes. In the other hand, it is actuated by instrument air. And the same is for this temperature valve also. It is modulated by air, and here we have the opening of the valve. where it you can see open, it means it is 100 open, and this time this valve is not controlling anything because usually the travel percentage for a control system is ranged from the best control system is ranged from 50 to 60, and if everything is stable, it do not modulate too much. But if you have a control valve that is always open, it means that it's not controlling anything. And here, so the chilled water comes from chilled system and going let to the heat exchanger, a plate one, at the top it changes to heat exchanger with the recirculation water, and it returns for the chilled system. And we can verify the temperature return in this TI. It's measuring here 15 Celsius. So it means that we have a water temperature around 5 Celsius and return with 15. So the temperature rise is 10 Celsius, and we can use that to evaluate the performance of the heat exchanger with others information also from the field. And the recirculation water comes here from this pipe, gets inside the heat exchanger in counter current it heat exchange, and goes outlet from the heat exchanger, where we can see a insulation valve also here, and temperature indicator transmitter. This one is the TIT that I show you in the PNID, where it was considered during the design that it was only a temperature transmitter. But as we have here the temperature indication, it is in fact a TIT instead of only a TT. And the pipe goes to the top of the scrubber. There, where it will be responsible for washing the gas and decreasing the gas temperature. This is the main circuit for this system, but we have also the drainage system. As the inlet gas is saturated with the water, when we decrease its temperature, the water that is in the gas is transferred for the liquid phase. So it means that the level in the scrubber will increase with the accumulation of the water, so we need to drain this column time to time. And to do that, we have here a on-off valve that is actuated by instrument air, and it sends the information for the control room. And this system is very similar to the others, where we have the isolation valve down upstream and downstream of the automatic valve. We have also a strain to prevent any blockage at the block valve, and we have a bypass also that is that is used if we need or to clean the strainer or if we need to do any maintenance in the isolation valve. And for startup, we need to consider also to add water to the scrubber, because in the first time it is dry, so we need to do some level before we can start the pump. Without level, the pump will run empty and that can damage the pumps. So we have here a PVC pipe where we receive processed water, and we have an isolation valve also, because it is supposed to compensate the level if the level of the scrubber gets too lower, and so to prevent shutdown in the system, because to not damage the pumps, and to prevent the, I forgot how to say that name, to prevent cavitation, we need to guarantee that we have a minimum level. So in the control philosophy, if the level in the scrubber gets a certain value, this valve should open to compensate the level. And we have the same arrangement here also, with two block valves, a strainer and a bypass for automatic valve and strainer maintenance. Besides that, to identify that the water needs to be filled, sent to the scrubber or if water needs to be drained from scrubber, we have here level taps. These taps is for level measurement, and we have here a level gauge, that the LG in the PNID, and we have there the LIT in the PNID, level indicator transmitter. And here the level of the water is here. It's not easy to see because the color of the fluid, but you can see here the level. And we have block valves to, in the case of a maintenance in this, and we have here a level tap that goes to one tap of the transmitter, and the other tap is in the top of this valve. Sorry, different than the TIT, this is in fact only a LT, a level transmitter, because there is no indication. Oh my, you can see the indication here, so this is in fact LIT, level indicator transmitter, because we have an indication in the field. We have a transmitter that send the information for the control room, and it is used to inform the level. So we have two steps because level in this, for this application is based on difference of pressure based on color weight. The software do a calculation and inform what is the level of the scrubber. So it is the scrubber system that we have worked during this week, talking at the PNID, and I believe that it was very important to show you this in the field to see what is the difference or what looks like when we do the drawing and we are at the field to understand how things happen. And thanks for following this video series, and I know that it was not the best video done I ever made, and there was a lot of inconsistencies, or the quality was not so good, but I did my best to bring to you a little bit of the life of a chemical process engineer in an industrial plant doing as built PNID and working with the operation team to get together information for basic engineering design development. And I hope you like it. Let me know if you can contact me in my social media. So I plan to bring to you other videos and other information related to chemical process engineering world. And see you, my friend, up to next video. And it's almost time to return to my home. See you soon.